Sushruta for Neet is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Hi students. So as we go about learning the material for this is for the incoming class 12 students, the program is aimed at providing some closure to the material that you have already experienced, as well as and then get ready for the new material that you will learn in class 12. Okay, our aim here is to make sure that at the end of the day you have sufficient background to navigate towards the NEET and JEE exams, and of course do very well in your class 12. You know, so that is an important goal as well. You know, and so as part of that preparation, we are going to start with the latter part of class 11, and then we will very quickly switch over to the class 12 material. So I am going to do a little bit of heat after this, but I'm going to start with the mechanical properties of solids first in today's lecture, and then from there we will navigate to navigate on to heat. Okay, so the mechanical properties of solids and later fluids, right, is the topic of discussion for today. So but before that, let me kind of once again explain to you how what the Jnanamarga study methodology should be for students. Okay, so typically what do? We provide an app. Okay, and this app is an ebook integrated with slides and videos. Okay, now when you read a textbook, right, sometimes textbooks are not easy to read, okay, and you do not understand everything, and it is as a result students are easily disheartened. Our aim is to make this process of reading a textbook easy, or at least if it is not easy, at least within within the realms of achievability. Okay, so you are making it possible for you to study without giving up, and so this is so for that we have the app. Okay, the app enables you to engage with the material. We have slides, we have videos, and we have also other ways by which the student can engage with different streams of study, including chat, etc. And of course, so the best way for students to study is while they are reading the textbook, also to look at the associated slides. Like for instance, the slides that I'm presenting today are there along with your textbook, and you can easily peruse through them. And of course, we also provide you the associated formula sheet, but most importantly, we integrate with the IIT PAN lectures. They come in context and in place so that while you're studying, if you have a doubt, you can then refer to the lecture as well. The lecture that you're watching today is also is made available to registered students. Okay, so if you become a registered student, then you will get a link to this lecture, and of course you can attend this live lecture and ask questions as well, and so that is the modus operandi for you. You read the book, you study the slides, you rewatch the videos, and you build a knowledge base. Then you take some tests. Okay, so now we have two apps. Okay, the Sushruta for NEET app is available from com.jnanamarga.sushruta. com.jnanamarga.sushruta, and you know, you will be able to gain access to it. You know, you follow the links, you go to our Facebook page, www.facebook.com/Jnanamarga Tech. Okay. And from there, you will get a link to the Play Store. Otherwise, you just go to Play Store and look for com.jnanamarga.sushruta, S-U-S-H-R-U-T-A. Okay. So you do that and you will reach our page. Okay. Now, what is available for students is that what we provide is an integrated learning platform, and students will get on top of the NCERT books, ebooks. They will, if you choose for the tablet, you will also get HC Verma as an ebook. You know, it is available on Kindle, you know, and it will be integrated with your learning. Okay. The plus point with having the ebook integrated with your learning is that you can follow along from the NCERT, then you can switch to the HC Verma, then you can look at the problems and solutions in HC Verma. It's up to you, you know, and then, you know, the student will also get the A to Z books with that, and then the full slide deck for all the subjects, and then, of course, 30 past years questions, okay, neat questions for the 30 years, okay. So these books, these extra books, will then give you a full system. You just buy one solution, and we also supply a tablet with you for you. Okay, so it all comes in the tablet, and all you have to do is study. You know, and it is not expensive. It is very affordable, 25,000, and you know, we can help you with you know, in ways that you best see fit. Okay, so now the voice recording is also available, and you can see the demonstration from our Facebook page. Okay, you can take mock tests with from EABRs and also from other places. Okay, so now the second app that we have is our flagship Ramanujan platform. The Ramanujan platform is meant for JE students. You know, so if you're interested in becoming an engineer, you should go opt for the Ramanujan platform. Similar way to get it, you go to Play Store, Google Play, and you look for, you know, in your Android phone, you can just bring up Google Play, and then you look for com.jnanamarga.ramanujan. Okay, so Jnanamarga, as I mentioned, J-N-A-N-A-M-A-R-G-A. So com.jnanamarga.ramanujan will get you to app. Just install that, and then you're up and away. Do a registration. If you have any issues with registration, just send a mail to support@jnanamarga.in. All right. The Ramanujan platform comes with the HC Verma book as well, ebook, and then we give you the CNGage Mathematics Tivani textbook, and along with that, Solomon's. And also 39 years of question bank, you know, you will get that as well. And then you with it, you get the same, the rest of the solution is similar, slides, IIT PAL videos, and Diksha app, you know. And so on top of all this, you have us, you know, we have a set of world-class teachers along with me teaching is Dr. Tiwari. He works with the NCL and is a PhD and is an amazing researcher and amazing teacher. Then you also have Professor G.K. Butt for the NEET students who are interested in biology. And then we also have Tarun teaching all the math students, you know, and these lectures are all ongoing. You just have to register your with the app, and then you know, you will get all the timings for all these lectures. Okay, so on to the business of the day, which is about the mechanical properties of matter and solids. Right, now how do solids behave? Solids have an important property. They have a volume, right? They have a fixed volume, right, compared to and a fixed shape, right? Solids, if you have a solid like this, it doesn't change its shape at all, right? And it stays like this pretty much, right? Now, the same is not true about liquids. Liquids take the form of whatever object that they are put in. So if you put it in a vessel, it will take the form of the vessel, right? Now, the third type of matter that we know of is gas, right? Gas occupies whatever space you provide it, right? So the difference between a liquid and a gas, the liquid has pretty much fixed volume, while the gas, the volume can change, right? So and both are what we call fluids. Okay, one is a fluid which can flow anywhere, and but its volume is fixed. The other is a fluid whose volume can change and can occupy any space. Okay, so that is the difference between a liquid and a gas, right? Now, among solids, you have a different set of processes. Okay, solids are elastic, which means that they can be slightly extended. Their length can be increased. Okay, and typically when you stretch, say, a string, you increase the length, its width will decrease a little bit, you know. So that ability to stretch a string is called elasticity. Okay, so now what happens when there is elasticity that we're going to look at? Okay, now rigidity, rigid bodies, like let's say you have a piece of metal, right? Don't do this. If you look at, say, a gold bar or an iron bar, you will find that you cannot compress it, etc., right? It is not elastic. It is said to be rigid. When force is applied, there is a deformation, right? So that is elasticity, okay? Now, if there is no deformation, we say that it is rigid, or in some ways, it is non-deformable piece of body. Okay, now elastic behavior is very important for engineering design and construction, right? The buildings that we build, the concrete, everything from concrete to wood that is used in building and brick, they all come with certain properties, and we study these properties as part of the mechanical properties of matter. Okay. Now, what causes this? What causes this amazing world that we live in terms of solids, liquids, and gases, right? That is because of this. To understand this, we have this picture. This is a graph of dealing with atomic forces. Now, inside an atom, which was the last material we studied in the last sections, okay, inside an atom you have this is a graph of the potential energy on the y-axis versus the distance on the x-axis. Now, at the slope of u versus x, right, will give you the force. Du by dx is the force. Okay, f dx will give you work, right? So du by dx is the force. Okay, so now at the bottom of this graph, right, you have the ideal distance, okay, the distance at which you have equilibrium, okay. Now, that is a little bit different for different types of solids, different types of molecules, and different types of compounds. Okay, so based on what type of compound, what are the composition of the elements, you will get at the end of the different answer. Okay, so for instance, ionic bonds are formed by crystal lattices. Okay, these crystal lattices will have a different R. Okay, see the bottom point, this point where you have the lowest potential energy is called R naught, is defined, is given by R naught. Okay, and that point is the point of equilibrium in that solid. Okay, now as you go up, right, you experience the forces start to either become negative or positive. Okay, on this side, remember it is negative du by dx, right? So on this side you have greater forces of attraction, on this side you have on this side you have some form of repulsion between the molecules. Okay, so based on which side of the curve you are, you will have a very different behavior of the element and its eventual constitution. Okay, but these interatomic forces is what dictates whether something is a solid, something is a liquid, whether it's a covalent bond, etc. Okay, and so the when we look at elastic behavior in solids, right? Now a solid very often, like for instance, if you take a stretchable string like a rubber band, right, the rubber band can stretch quite far, right? You pull it and you pull it and you pull it and it extends significantly. Like elasticity is what most people experience when they wear an underwear, right? Underwear, the top part of the underwear elongates, right? It can shrink and it can elongate, right? Now these are things that behave like springs, and we looked at springs, right? The elongation in a spring is proportional to the force. F is equal to kx, which is called Hooke's law. We looked at Hooke's law when we looked at simple harmonic motion, right? Now Hooke's law occurs within a range of the applied force, beyond which typically if you pull the elastic rod, the elastic string too much, it will then cut or it will deform, you know, and so that is called the point of deformation. Okay, so now there is this idea of stress and strain. Okay, the greater the amount you pull, right, that is the deforming force, right? So now I have a string and I'm pulling it. Okay, as I pull it, inside there's an equal and opposite internal force which is called stress. Okay, now that is that is measured as per unit area. So if you have a very thick piece of rubber, right, and you pull it, you have to put so much more force than if you had a thin rubber band, right? So now that force, it stretches based on the force per unit area that you apply. If you have very thick rubber band, then the area is bigger, right? The cross-sectional area is bigger. So then the force per unit area is decided by also not just by the force you apply, right, but also by the thickness. I don't know if you have seen these bodybuilders who have to pull these these stretchable things, right? They apply a force. Now if you keep a very thin thing, it's easy to pull, but if you have like nice big spring, right, you really have to make an effort, right? That's why you become a bodybuilder. You build strength by doing that, right? Now so that is the ability to stretch a body is called tensile stress, longitudinal stress. Okay, now the level of stress leads, the level of stress applied leads to a longitudinal strain. Okay, what is strain? Strain is the ratio of the elongation to the original length. Okay, so as you elongate, right, delta L, for each delta L by L, you have a corresponding, that is proportional to the force applied. Okay, so if you extend it by a certain amount, it is because you applied a certain amount of force. Okay, so now there is this thing called Young's modulus, and I'll come to that. Now, sometimes you have what is called shearing strain. Two opposing forces, okay, that are tangential. Okay, so now I have something, let's say a block like this, and I'm pushing here and I'm pushing there. Okay, otherwise I screw it onto the to a board and then I pull one side, right? So now I'm shearing the body. Okay, there is, because it's screwed on, when I pull at the top alone, it is kind of shearing. Okay, this is not linear stress, longitudinal stress when I have a body and pull it this way. This, the body is like this, and I'm applying a tangential force called shear. That force is called shear. Okay, so that is called shearing strain. Okay, now shearing strain also happens. I don't know if how many of you have heard of the Leaning Tower of Pisa. The Leaning Tower of Pisa, instead of being like this, it is a little bit tilted. Okay, so now when the wind hits, what happens to the Leaning Tower of Pisa? It like that. Okay, tall buildings, which are like, you know, these 100 story buildings, right? Which you see, like, right? If you go to Bombay or you go to New York City, you will see these 100-story buildings, right? Now, these buildings in the wind, they will sway a little bit. You know, you see the tree, of course. The other thing is the tree, right? A lot of, there is a redwood down my street, which is almost 100 feet tall, okay? Now, these tall trees, they also sway in the wind, and they are subject, on the one side, they are rooted in the ground, and on the other side, the wind hits it, and then the tree little bit bends this way, that way, to the wind, and reflects a certain longitudinal shear, or not longitudinal, a little bit of transverse shear, or tangential shear, okay? So, these are the two ideas, okay, in stress and strain. One is longitudinal strain, longitudinal force, applied to increase the body, and the other is the tangential force, which is leads to shear. Okay, so then there is a third idea. Okay, then there is what is called, what happens in fluids. Okay, this is used in things like braking systems. Okay, what is called hydraulic brakes, right? Hydraulic compression in fluids. When a fluid, right, inside a body, right, looks to press back at a force of stress applied. So you can stress the fluid also, and you can try to compress it. It will then hold the energy that you applied to it, and then it will respond to that compression by volume, by applying a volume. What you are doing is you are applying a volume strain, right? You're trying to reduce its volume, right? And so it absorbs that energy, and then it develops what is called hydraulic stress, and it pushes back in this direction and that direction. That is how hydraulic brakes work. So to get started, so that is a qualitative understanding of these ideas. Okay, now we go to the quantitative understanding. We all know Hooke's law, right? F equals kx, right? Now, for a small levels of stress, right, basically what Hooke said is that the stress is proportional to the strain. Okay. Now, the constant that relates stress and strain, stress ST is proportional to STR. Right. So, what is stress? Stress is force per unit area. Okay. And what is the strain? Strain is the extension per unit length. Okay. So, now the extension that you provide, like, right, delta L, let's say you increase it by a certain delta L. That extension is delta L divided by the original length is proportional to the force per unit area that you applied. Okay. So, that is Hooke's law. So, stress over strain is a constant. So, if you plot stress, you plot strain in the y-axis, you plot stress in the, you plot strain, stress in the y-axis, strain in the x-axis, then you, and you draw a curve, you will end up with a constant. Okay. That constant is known as the modulus of elasticity. It is a linear relationship between stress and strain. So, and the name for, in the case of longitudinal stress and strain, is called Young's modulus. Okay. Now, the stress versus strain curve doesn't, as we discussed before, there is a point at which it starts to not come back to its original length. Okay. Now, if you look at this, right, over the O is this point. O is this point, over, right? Over OA, there is a linear relationship between stress and strain. Okay, that the ratio of the stress to strain is called Young's modulus. It's a straight line. Okay, so for each increase in delta L, you will have to apply a corresponding higher force. Okay, per unit area. Okay, and but after a certain point, that linearity disappears. The yield point or elastic limit is the point after which the body does not regain its original shape. It will, at then there is a point at which it goes into a fracture. That is this point. Okay. So there is a yield point. Okay. There is a point B, which is called the yield point, right? Yield, so then there is a brief area and then there is the yield point, right? After the yield point, the body will not become as it was before. It will not regain its original shape. We go to some slight deformation, right? That deformation is said to be plastic deformation. The point D on the graph is the ultimate tensile strength, okay? So, the ultimate tensile strength is the point, this is the ultimate tensile point, okay, the point D, right? So, there the material is about to give, okay, it's about to give, okay? Now, if D, this is D, right? If D and the point of fracture are very close, it is said to be brittle, okay? If they are far apart, it is said to be ductile. Okay. Now, what is ductile? Okay. Now, if you look at metals, right? Metals are ductile. Okay. Glass is brittle. Glass, if you patak, it will break. So, the things that are brittle will break. If that point between D and E is very large, it is said to be ductile. Okay, the things that are most ductile are things like metal wire. Okay, now I'm sure you have seen these bridges, right? You've seen these bridges with they are held together by very thick steel wire. Okay, now this steel wire, like for instance the Manhattan Bridge, is held by pretty much maybe 20 different or 34 30 different cables. They hang a whole bridge, right? these bridges are, that's why they are called suspension bridges. The bridge is like, you know, it's the weight of the bridge is being held by a few thick wires. This is carrying cars, it's carrying this, it's carrying that, but it's being held by a few wires. Okay, now think of the strength of these wires. Okay, now those materials, you know, those materials, they have to stretch, but they can't break. If they break, think, imagine the disaster that would happen, right? So that the study of all this is all these things between stress and strain, etc., are extremely important in construction. You know, so if you become a civil engineer, or become an architect, it is good to understand the physics of materials and how they work. Okay, now elastomers, right? Elastomers are very stretchable material or tissue. You know, rubber and tissue of the aorta are considered elastomers when it is stretchable. Okay, so it is somewhat stretchable. See, like for instance, the veins and arteries through which blood flows, right? It has to stretch and shear, while the blood is just like flowing all over your body, right? So these are the study of all this is what we are looking at, and this is the whole science behind this. Okay? So now let's come back to what we are here to study, which is Young's modulus. Young's modulus tells us that sigma, which is the stress divided by the longitudinal strain, is a constant in that OA phase. Okay. Now, F over A is the stress. Force per unit area is the stress. The delta L over L is the strain. Okay. Now, you can then rewrite it as F times L divided by A times delta L. Most often, you will end up in that equation. And of course, let's look at an example. Okay, a simple example: a copper wire of length 2.2 meters and a steel wire of length 1.6 meters, both with a diameter very thin, 3 millimeters. Okay, are connected end to end. Okay, when stretched by a load, the extension is found to be 0.7 millimeter. So together, the length is 2.2 plus 3.8. Okay. 2.2 plus, that is the original length, right? Of both together. The net elongation of both together is 0.7. Okay. Obtain the load applied. Now, you all know the each has the diameter of 3 millimeters. So, you know the area, pi r square, right? Right. Pi, R is 1.5 millimeters, right? Pi times 1.5 square will give you the area of the copper wire, right? So when stretched, right? So now the force is a constant. So what you do know is you also do know the Young's modulus of each of these, copper and steel. Right, you know the Young's modulus, right? So now, from the table, the Young's modulus is of copper 1.1 into 10 to the power of 11, right? The other one is 2.0 into 10 to the power of 11 Newton per meter square. Now, stress is a force, the force is to be determined, right? It is the weight, load applied, right? W by pi r square equals dl by l. dl is, and the force per unit area is the same for both. Okay, so stress over strain equals constant, but the constant is different for each of these. So the stress is fixed, right? So the first one has y times strain 1 for copper, y times strain 2 for steel. So y times strain 2 strain 1 for copper equals y times strain 2 for steel. What we don't know, we only know the total elongation. That is, we know delta LC plus delta LS. Delta LC plus delta LS equals 0.7 into 10 to the power of minus 4, right? So the net elongation is the elongation of the copper plus the elongation of the steel, right? So delta LC plus delta LS equals 0.7, right? So now you have one equation, and you have which is YC times delta L over LC equals YS times delta LS over LS. So that is one equation. The other equation is DLC plus DLS equals 0.7. So now let's say you substitute one into the other, right? So you write DLS is 7 into 10 to the power of minus 4 minus DLC, and you plug that into the equation. So then you already know their lengths, 2.2 and 1.6, right? So you know the YC, you know the YS. So two equations and two unknowns, you solve for DLC. Okay, and then once you solve for DLC, you also know DLS. And from that, once you have solved for both of these, you can then get W over A. Okay, and A you know, therefore you will get W. Okay, so that's how you solve this particular problem. Okay, so now we're going to look at an experiment to determine the Young's modulus. So how do I determine the Young's modulus? For that, you need some unknown material. Let me explain that carefully. Okay, let's say you have some material. Okay, this material is called the reference material. It is a, it has a wire. It is in its OA region. Always remember that on both of them have to be in the OA region. That is a very important point of this problem. Okay, you cannot put so much weight that it deforms. You have to be in that stretchable region. I don't know if you have sometimes see after some time. you know, it, this happened to me. It is an embarrassment. You know, I gained some weight. My underwear, you know, stretched too much, and then it did not come back to its original shape. It became bigger and bigger, and then I had to throw away my underwear, buy a new underwear. I had to change, wear a different, my waist size increased. You know, so that is again a stress. Stress was a strain problem. Okay. again, these things are, I am telling you, it is an embarrassing thing to state that you have, your waist height has gone up, but it is not so bad, such a bad deal. It happens to all of us. Okay. Anyway, so this, on this side, right, you have the reference wire, which is stretched by a certain weight. Okay. Now on this side also, you start out with a fixed weight, okay, and you then have a vernier which is kept at exactly a horizontal level. Okay, so now you start with this reference point, right? This one has a certain weight, this one has a different weight, right? Or same weight. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I keep it like this, right? So there's this wire and there's the reference. Okay, so now I'm going to add weights on this side. On the experimental side, I'm going to keep adding weights. So the more I add, the angle will start to change. Okay, and the change is dictated, right? So now the line connecting these two is going to slide down. Okay, now as this line slides down, what is happening, right? That is because the experimental wire of the same length is elongating. Okay, so it is tied at a certain point, at an initial reference point. As I add more weights, this side is elongating, right? So this length of the wire is becoming longer and longer. One important point here is that this lower part of this also as part of the weight, right? That weight is not changing. That is a very important point, okay? Only these weights that I add is changing. That's why you have you start with an initial experiment, you keep it horizontal, then you keep adding a fixed amount, okay? As you add a fixed amount, what you find is the load increases, okay? Now, you will then see that as the ratio of the weight that you add to the elongation, corresponding elongation, is a straight line, okay? So that ratio is, ng, see, this horizontal length is fixed, right? So now, as this side it goes up, right, the tan of that angle, right? So tan of that angle is this elongation by that, right? This angle is what you measure, okay? So now this angle, right, is the tan of this angle is the extension divided by the length, okay? So that will stay, the extension is proportional to the weight that you are continuously adding, okay? So here, y equals mg times l divided by pi r squared times delta l, okay? So now, mg over delta l will be a constant. Delta l over mg is tan theta, okay? So, and so that is how you measure the Young's modulus, right? Because you have measured all the rest. You measured this m, you know, the r you have measured, the l you have measured, right? So all the rest you have measured, okay? So the Young's modulus, you get the value of the Young's modulus by understanding the increase in this versus the increase in that, okay? So that is the nature of that experiment, how you calculate the Young's modulus of wire. You may, as part of your class 11, you may have done this experiment for your physics. A lot of people's schools have this Young's modulus experiment, and I vaguely remember doing it once, you know. But if you missed it because of coronavirus and whatever else, right? don't worry about it. You can definitely see a YouTube video, okay? And that will also help you understand this subject better, okay? And part of my effort also is to make sure that it is, also there is a physical understanding of these things, okay? Now, we also looked at the shear, right? Shear happens when one half of a material sees a tangential force and the other half, there is a kind of, what do you call it? Dipole, two opposing forces of equal magnitude in this way and that way are applied on something, okay? So that, and that leads to what is called shear. Shear, this side pushing this way, that side pushing that way, and there is a kind of, it's going to tear in a different way, okay? Now, shear, or you see it in many places, shear force also deforms many bodies, okay? And the ability to manage shear also is very, very important, particularly in the context of, as I explained, construction, okay? The shearing stress by the shearing strain also stays a certain constant, okay? Now, the extension in this case is delta X over L, okay? So, and the force over area is the shearing stress, okay? You're pushing on two sides, okay? So now let's look at an example. A square lead slab of size 50, okay? Square lead slab of side 50, right? 50, 50, it's a square, right? And thickness 10 centimeters is subject to a shearing force, okay, on its narrow phase, okay. So on its narrow phase, like this, narrow phase, like this, okay. So on its narrow phase is subject to a shearing force, okay. Much narrow phase, okay. Now of 104 newtons, the lower edge is riveted to the floor. How much will the upper edge be displaced? Okay. So the stress applied is 9.4 times 104. Okay. So 104 by 0.05. Okay, 0.05 is what? 0.05 is the area, because its length is 10 centimeters, its width is 50 centimeters. So 10 times 50 is the area, 0.05 meter square. Okay, so the shearing strain is dx over L. Okay, so the shearing strain is dx over L. D is the displacement, right? Displacement by the length. Length, you know, is 0.5, right? So dx over L by G will give you the shearing strain. Okay, and therefore stress times L by G will give you. So dx over L is the strain, right? Dx over L is the strain, right? Now stress by G, right? Stress by G will then give you the value of dx. Dx equals stress times L over G. Okay. So from that you will get because stress over strain is a constant, right? You will end up with the corresponding displacement of the slab, right? In this case, this delta L is what we are looking at. Okay, how much will it displace in a particular direction? Okay, when you push it in that direction, looked at the area, we looked at the force you are applying, and from that we use the what is called shearing stress of the material. Okay, so now the final idea was with respect to hydraulic strain. Hydraulic strain is determined by the bulk modulus. The bulk modulus is the pressure, is the ratio of the pressure divided by the volume strain. Okay, the pressure is surface pressure, right? So the surface pressure divided by the volume strain will give you the bulk modulus. The bulk modulus is also called compressibility. The levels, you know, if you compress it, it holds in some pressure and then it is pushing back at you. So on the surface of the, and that's where the pressure is. Okay. So, you also have this K, which is 1 over V, which is the inverse of it. Okay. So, and that is a bulk modulus. So here's an example. The average depth of the Indian Ocean is 3000 meters. Calculate the fractional compression delta V over V of water at the bottom of the ocean, given that the bulk modulus of water is so much. The pressure exerted by a 3000 meter column of water on the bottom layer, right, is so much, right? You have 1000 kgs times mg, right? 3000 meters times 1000 kgs, right? So that gives you the pressure. Okay, so and the fractional compression will be therefore delta V over V equals stress by B. Okay, so and here we are trying to calculate the delta V to how much will how much will the water be compressed, the bottom water, right? At the bottom of the ocean, how tight will the water be compressed? Because how much pressure is being put on it? The water above it, right? That is almost 3,000 meters of water, right? There's enormous stress at that level. So 3 into 10 to the power of 7, right? Divided by 2.2 into 10 to the power of 9. Okay. Therefore, the ratio of that is 1.36 into 10 to the power of minus 2, which is the resultant fractional compression. So, the at the bottom of the ocean, what they are saying is, because the B here, stress by B, this is B, okay, this is B, 2.2 into 10 to the power of 9, okay. Now, this is 3 into 10 to the power of 7 is the stress, this one, pressure per unit area, okay. So, pressure per unit area is, force per unit area is pressure, right? So, force per unit area is 3 into 10 to the power of 7. The bulk modulus is known. They've given it to you, 2.2 into 10 to the power of 9 newtons per meter square, right? And G is, we've taken G to be 10. And so, from that, the compression of the water at the bottom of the ocean is 1.36%. There's enormous pressure, which means that it is somewhat compressed. Okay. Now, the final idea in this is the ratio of the lateral strain to the longitudinal strain is called Poisson ratio. Okay. The lateral strain to the longitudinal strain is called the Poisson ratio. Okay. Now, the work done is given by this. Okay. W times A, W equals Young's modulus times A times I square by 2L, or it is half Y times strain square times volume. Okay. Half Y times strain square times volume. Okay. Y, or it is the same as stress times strain by 2. Okay. So, stress times, the work done is stored in the form of elastic potential energy, right? That is stress times strain divided by 2. And we know that stress and strain are related by Y equals, stress equals K times strain, right? And that's why you have this this formula, okay? This comes from this, okay? So, half times Young's modulus times strain square times volume of the wire, okay? So, volume of the wire comes because you end up with pi r squared times L, okay? Half times Young's modulus times strain square times volume, okay? So, that was going to give you the work, okay? And the ratio of the lateral stress, okay, so to the longitudinal strain, lateral strain to the longitudinal strain, okay. So here's the thing, when you pull something, right, its radius is going to compress a little bit, okay. Now, the extension to which that radial compression happens is, the Poisson's ratio. Okay, so the lateral strain to the longitudinal strain, that is, gives you Poisson's ratio. Okay, and then finally, the last idea that we discussed was the work, and the work is sigma times epsilon by 2, where sigma is the stress and epsilon is the strain. That is also half Y strain square times volume. Okay, so with that, I come to the end of this presentation. I'll quickly go over another set of slides that I do have, and that shouldn't take that much time. And then we can, kind of end this for today. Okay. So, 1 minute. Okay. So now we will quickly look at, you know, what are the mechanical properties of fluids, right? We already discussed some of this earlier in this lecture, but I wanted to get this done. Okay. There are three states of matter as we discussed. Solids have a definite shape and size. When we apply pressure to change it, the change in the volume is negligible, and it may be very small and probably you can't see it. Okay. Liquids also have a similar story. The volume changes are small, right? But we already saw that in the case of bulk modulus, etc. Right? But since it cannot take any shear stress, if you push water, it will just flow that way, right? If you push water on one side, it will flow. It will just make part ways with the other side. So it cannot take any shear stress. It does not have any shape or size, right? It will take whatever container you put it into. While solids have a definite shape, right? In gases, the change in volume is enormous when we apply pressure, right? So for that, we learn other laws, PV equals NRT, Boyle's law, etc., right? And when we fill a tire with air, the air does not go to the bottom. Instead, it fills the space available uniformly, right? When we remember that, although gases occupy any space, right, they do so not very willingly. Even they protest, and that is why you have you have so much pressure on the tire. What you measure when you pump air is the pressure, right? When we pour liquid in the tire, it goes to the bottom and starts building up from there, right? Well, in the case of gas, it will occupy whatever space is available uniformly. So liquids and gases do not have specific shape. They can flow, but liquids have a set volume. Okay, so therefore we say that things that do not have a specific shape are called fluids. Liquids and gases are called fluids because they are capable of flowing. Okay, so there is another state of matter which happens at very high temperature when the atoms are stripped of all the electrons from the outer shells. They acquire a charge and they become ions. That state of matter is called plasma. Okay, and for instance, the sun has significant plasma because it's a very high temperature. Okay, so some scientists also say that colloids, which are suspensions of tiny particles in a liquid, as also a different state of matter, but that is some scientists. You don't have to know that this just a passing thing. It's not going to be tested, and don't include it in your knowledge base. Okay. Presence of fluids. The air we breathe is fluid. Okay, the human body is 90%+ water, which is a fluid. Lot of processes that go in human bodies, including plants, are mediated by fluids. Okay. Fluids have an enormous role to play, notably water, in the process of life. Okay, interatomic perspective of fluids. Okay. Solids have different shapes because the intermolecular forces of attraction is very large. We looked at, if you remember, the first slide we looked at or the second slide we looked at was that curve, intermolecular forces, right? Intermolecular force graph, that is, the potential energy versus the distance. The slope of that curve dictates the du by dx is the force, intermolecular force. So solids have a definite shape because the intermolecular force of attraction is very large, right? These attractions or interactions keep the molecules together. Intermolecular force of attraction in liquids is small, but it's not negligible. The intermolecular forces in gases is negligible. Okay, so solids have the greatest intermolecular force. The liquids have less intermolecular force, but it's not negligible. And gases, of course, have almost no intermolecular forces. Some of the mechanical properties that distinguish the different states of matter are density and specific gravity. Okay, so those are the mechanical properties of matter. We are looking at mechanical properties of solids with stress versus strain, and now also fluids. Okay, now block of wood or iron, which is heavier? You all know density. What is that? Archimedes' principle, right? Block of wood is lighter. Iron is heavier, right? A large log of wood is definitely heavier than a small block of iron, but you know what matters is the density. So the block of wood, right? Wood has a higher weight, a lower weight per unit volume. Okay, so its weight per unit volume is less than that of water. That's why it floats in water. Let's denote the density by rho, mass per unit volume, right? And the density is denoted by mass per unit volume. So the density is the property of the substance, and no matter the size or shape of the substance, okay, it is the same. Okay, density is doesn't change with shape or size. It stays the same. Now the SI unit of density is kilograms per meter cube, mass per unit volume, right? Kilograms per meter cubed, and in CGS, grams per cm cubed. Okay, and you have all these, you know, water is 1000, right? Iron is 7800, aluminium is 2700, wood is 500, glass is 2500, ethyl alcohol is 790, right? The values are quoted at a temperature 0 degrees and pressure of 1 atmosphere, okay? So, glass has density 3 orders of magnitude less when compared to solids. Gases have densities of 3 orders of magnitude less than solids, right? See, 1.29, this is 1000, okay? So, this is 3 orders of magnitude less. This is 1, this is 1000, air versus water, right? Helium is even less, 0.179, right? These are at 1 atmosphere, you know. PV equals NRT, so you have to keep T and P the same, right? If you keep P and T the same, then you can say you will be doing an apples to apples comparison, because it's PV equals NRT. We'll discuss that, you know, in the next class, okay? So, and this is, why do gases have such low density? Because they have negligible force of attraction between the atoms, okay? So if you have, they give you the density, they give you the radius of the sphere, then mass per unit volume is rho. That's the calculation they are doing here. So with that, I'm going to conclude today's lecture. We looked at the mechanical properties of matter. I would suggest that you read the two corresponding chapters. In one dealing with, you know, there are actually three chapters, here, two or three chapters here. The first one is called fluid, deals with fluid mechanics, you know, fluid mechanics. The second one, which is closer to what we discussed in great detail, some mechanical properties of matter. A lot of your slides were made using your NCERT textbook. You are welcome to read the very well written NCERT textbook, and you know, these ideas also, they stretch from here. You know, they form a basis of what you learn, but they are much more important in chemistry. Okay, so next class onwards, my suggestion is you read H.C. Verma Part 1, the final you know, the corresponding chapters there. Otherwise, you read the chapters in your NCERT textbook and you attempt some problems so that you're good with, you know, mechanical properties of matter and fluids. And next class onwards, I will do a little bit of heat. And subsequent to that, we will go back to the class 12 material and, you know, take things forward from there. Okay. But stay safe till then. And I will see you again next week. If it is Sunday morning, it is the lecture for the class 12 students or incoming class 12 students. If it is Saturday morning, it is the lecture for the incoming class 11 students. If you want to join that, you're welcome to join that. We are discussing a little bit of, next we are going to discuss calculus for physics next class. And then from there on, we are going to move on to the material with mechanics. Okay. So if you want to get that revision, you're welcome to do that. Otherwise, you're of course welcome to take a look at our YouTube channel, which has a ton of very useful videos, very well organized and put in place. And you should of course take this chance to download our apps and make the most of it. Stay safe, stay healthy, and but don't waste your summers. Distance learning gives you that chance to study very hard and do justice to you know, your exams when they show up, you know. And believe me, before the end of this year, we will be back in business and you know, regular school, and everybody will have to.
Welcome to Sushruta app. In this video, we are going to demo NEET topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select Biology 11th as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the first subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the third icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IITPAL. If there are more than one video, select any one of the links and watch the video. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, taxonomic categories, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook. So here we have the textbook resource showing taxonomic categories. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Biology Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the biology syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is Gyan Chat. Gyan Chat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let us click the textbook icon, and select the second option. This will open up a message box, displaying the page number, of the Kindle version of H.C. Verma book. On clicking OK it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top, and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box, asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Now let us see the formula sheet for physics. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the C-Engage app. On clicking the C-Engage icon, it will open the C-Engage app. You will find all the test material inside my bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF. In some cases, there will be video content, graphic and interactive content. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Hello, my dear students. Very glad to meet you all. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. In 2018 or during 2018 to 2020, I got an opportunity to visit nearly 25 institutions. And I used to teach in all these institutions biology, preparing the students for NEET exam. For NEET exam, you must be thorough with each and every word given in the NCERT book. That means biology, you have to by heart the NCERT book. Not simply by heart, understanding the concept and by heart. That is what is expected. Now let us start with this particular chapter, that is Animal Kingdom. And we shall look into the various components that is given here in the NCERT, in the Animal Kingdom. Under basis of classification, what we are looking, what characters, what points we are looking to classify the animals, that is what we are studying under basis of classification. In spite of differences in structure and form of different animals, there are a lot of difference in the structure, in their form, gross morphology. There are certain fundamental features common to various individuals. In relation to arrangement of cells, body symmetry, nature of coelom, patterns of digestive system, circulatory system, or
respiratory. We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.